This program is brought to you by Agnes Scott College. For more information about Agnes Scott College, please visit our website at agnesscott.edu.
Good evening. Or afternoon. I guess it's still afternoon. Good afternoon. And welcome to the Gladden Lecture for 2017. It is such a thrill to see the wide range of folks who have come to this presentation, from current students to faculty colleagues to former first dudes. I'm not sure what the official title is, George Bullock's official title is. But also a number of dear friends and former students of Lesley's, including Sarah, who came from Alabama, and folks who've come from far afield to hear Professor Lesley Coia deliver the 2017 Gladden Lecture. And it's really a pleasure for me to introduce Lesley. I am so sorry that in this 14th year of the Gladden Lecture, Joe and Sally Gladden are not able to join us today. They were planning to be here. They were hoping until just a little while ago that they could make it. Sally had had some surgery and it's all gone fine. There were some complications and as a result, her doctor told her she really shouldn't be on the road. So we're videotaping it. So it will be possible for Joe and Sally to listen to this lecture. And as I think you all know, this lecture was created as a way of saying thank you to Joe Gladden, who served as the chair of the Board of Trustees in a very, very important period in Agnes Scott's history. He was a remarkable leader and partner with Mary Brown Bullock in keeping the college strong and growing it and doing all sorts of wonderful things for Agnes Scott. And the purpose of the Gladden Lecture Award is to identify a member of the Agnes Scott faculty whose scholarly accomplishments are especially noteworthy. And so it's really a chance for us with a wider audience to showcase the wonderful scholarship of the teacher scholars who form the Agnes Scott faculty. In the case of Professor Lesley Coia, what's especially beautiful, I sort of feel like you're at the very heart of our mission because you are a widely published and internationally recognized scholar, but your scholarship focuses on teaching and so and is deeply grounded in practices of the examined life and self-reflection and personal development. So Professor Coia's work is really captures at its heart what a community, a learning community, a liberal arts college like Agnes Scott is about teaching and learning, about that transformative work that happens on the part of both those who teach and those who learn and unites them. And she is, as I mentioned, widely published. She has edited 3 books, and I'm just going to give you their titles, and you can see how they really relate to what we're about. Critical Thinking and Learning, Democratic Responses in an Era of Standardization, and Gender, Feminism, and Queer Theory in the Self-Study of Teacher Education Practices. Since coming to Agnes Scott in 2002, she has become a beloved professor, has directed our Center for Teaching and Learning, directed our teacher education and MAT programs, has twice won the Holder Faculty Innovation Award, and she looks surprised. I believe that's right. And has been a transformative force in the lives of students, including many who have gone on in the teaching profession and have had their lives deeply enriched by their work with Dr. Coia. She is also, among the areas of specialization, autoethnography, self-development and teaching, as well as refugee education, education with diverse learners, and gender and race in education. So things that, again, are very much at the heart of what Agnes Scott stands for. So we are so thrilled that she is our colleague, that she is a wonderful teacher scholar in our community and contributes so much to our community. And we're very much looking forward to hearing her talk about placing trust in education. So please join me in giving a warm welcome and raucous applause to Professor.
Well, thank you all for coming. The reception's going to be very good. We have chocolate digestives for our students who I know they've come. Anyway, but I hope you'll all stay for the reception. The title of my talk is Placing Trust in Education, and I'm afraid I'm going to read it because I'm a bit nervous, but I'll try and have asides whenever I can. So, can you all hear me? Good. So, teaching at Agnes Scott and being a member of this community is an honor. I've taught in many places, from Sweden, England, and elsewhere in the USA, but over the past 14 years at Agnes Scott, my understanding of what it means to teach and learn has been fundamentally enriched. I have many of those here present to thank. Tonight, I would like to share some of what I've learned about one crucial aspect of this relationship, trust. Trust is mostly invisible to us. It's part of the air we breathe. It's not something to which we give much attention in our normal lives. As Annette Beyer, in one of the most memorable quotes on trust, says, there we go, we inhabit a climate of trust as we inhabit an atmosphere and notice it as we notice air, only when it becomes scarce or polluted. So, why look at it now, here? I certainly don't want to suggest that the air at Agnes Scott is in any way polluted. In fact, the argument I wish to present is that looking at good relations of trust can tell us much about what we value in education. It can help us understand what we do a little more clearly. There is something to be learned from the good air we breathe. My interest in trust was set in motion my first year at Agnes Scott. During the fall semester, I was increasingly struck by the quality of the interactions between myself and the students with whom I worked. In this new environment, I was led to reflect on my own teaching stance. My journal that year contains many entries such as, I shared part of myself today without planning to. As we worked together in a group with me fully participating, I found myself expressing my genuine ambivalence about experiential learning. It didn't seem intrusive or inappropriate, but it was surprising to me. It situated me differently in a class in relation to the students and seemed to allow for new insights to emerge from both students and me. This is a new sense of feeling vulnerable, and it seems positive. Today, I would say we drew closer in our work, but why, when I think about what happened in class, do I think it was a matter of growing trust between myself and the students? Tonight, I would like to explore the idea that what I was feeling was trust, and that trust matters in education. Although there are many aspects of this large and amorphous subject that deserve to be considered, I'll limit my remarks to what I think is the heart of the issue, what it means to trust and be trusted in the context of teaching and learning. I first began teaching in the early 80s at a relatively well-known community school, Langdon Park, in Poplar, in the East End of London. Some of you may know Poplar from the PBS series Call the Midwife. And to be quite honest, in the early 80s, there were areas of Poplar that hadn't changed much since the 50s. It was a great school in a very poor area of London. The students, to give you some idea, looked very much then as they do now. This is from their current website. During that first heady experience of teaching in the neighborhood where I lived, I hoped to achieve at least two pedagogical aims: to write the perfect lesson plan and to make myself invisible as a teacher. These are laudable, if flawed, aims. The first imagines that learning depends on something abstract like a blueprint, And the second is an admission that the teacher, by her very presence, can hinder rather than enhance the learning process. My years of teaching since have taught me that while being prepared and teacher self-abnegation have their place, the joys and challenges of teaching lie elsewhere. They lie in the continually changing pedagogical encounter, an encounter between people engaging with each other and a text. Tonight, I'll explore with you my deepening understanding of this educative relationship. I shall start by providing a little background. I'll quickly remind us why trust is important in education, and then go on to suggest ways of talking about trust that avoids some of the definitional pitfalls that traditionally plague it. This will be done by focusing on our particular context and asking what trust between teacher and student might mean. This will involve looking in some detail at the type of relationship that holds between a teacher and student. This naturally, and somewhat excitingly, leads us to ask important questions about the meaning of education and to see the useful conceptual work that trust can do for us. This will be the positive part of the lecture. I'll close by an expert preemption of any objections by addressing them myself. And notwithstanding this, I'll leave ample time at the end, I think, for further discussion of the issues I address. I hope by the end of the hour you will be as excited and intrigued by trust as I am. So, what is trust? This is a quote from Cecilia Bock. Whatever matters to human beings, trust is the atmosphere in which it thrives. I'd like to start by recounting a story from one of my classes. Many of the classes I teach address social issues, social justice issues in education. Some years ago, a student came to me at the beginning of a discussion on heterosexism to explain that she was not going to participate. She was very sorry, but she would not read, write about, or discuss the issues as they ran contrary to her belief system. She came to class, but she mentally withdrew. She did not complete the assignments. Before class, she had always liked to come and work in the space outside my office, and this she still did, although she conspicuously did not read the text, but instead read a novel. We talked during this time, as we had always done, about her courses, her plans, and so on. We did not talk about her decision not to do the work on heterosexism. Sometime later, after the unit was finished, she came to me and said that after talking to relatives and members of her community, she felt she could now do the work from the perspective of the social justice aims of her own faith and upbringing. We'll return to this story of trust a little later, but first we must situate our discussion with a brief consideration of why trust is important. As in other areas of our life, education would not be possible without trust. It is central to our lives and our flourishing. Despite, or perhaps because it's so pervasive, it is not something to which we give much thought. It's the norm. We live our lives depending on others to meet our expectations. We need the help of others to attain things we care about or need that we cannot get by ourselves. As one of the few to address the question of trust in education, Suzanne Rice says, "To become educated, we need the help of others. To receive that help, we must trust." A moment's reflection shows the truth of this. Students take on trust much of what we teach, and we need to trust our students in order to teach. For no matter how experiential we are in our teaching, much of what we say and provide for our students cannot be personally verified for them. And for us to be able to teach, we have to trust that our students are willing and able to learn. This is the basic or background trust that rarely comes to conscious awareness. Other more reflective forms of trust are also important. Recent research, not surprisingly, shows that strong relationships of trust between members of an educational community bear significantly on students' commitment and confidence in learning and students' ability to construct knowledge. One would expect trust to play an important role in education, since teaching and learning is a complex, cooperative endeavor, and cooperative ventures are generally assumed to require trust. Yet, as a philosophical concept in education, trust seems largely taken for granted. It seems, as I said above, that it's something that only comes to our attention in its absence or when it's lacking. This hasn't gone unnoticed in education. Andy Hargreaves says, for example, issues of trust surface less when trust is honored than when it is breached. It's the difficulties of trust that normally concern us. It's not surprising then that most of the attention to trust in education focuses on problems of trust, whether this is in educational institutions. I think this was a conference that some people here went to recently, the AACNU, Building Public Trust in Education, or in teachers. In this talk, however, it is not the repair needed to restore trust that's the focus, but the role trust plays in our conception of education, as evidenced by the story I've just told. So, what is it? My first response when I began thinking about what was happening in my classes that first year at Agnes Scott was to wonder why I thought what I was feeling was trust. Why not confidence, belief, or even growing familiarity? As I wrote in my journal and spoke to colleagues and students, I quickly realized that despite its importance to our lives, trust poses special problems when we come to specify exactly what we mean by it. And it was par for the course to be wondering whether what I was experiencing was a feeling of trust or something else. Asking what trust is, as one author has said, is much like Augustine's observation about time. We know what it is when no one asks us, but once they do, we don't know what to answer. There is no doubt that ordinary usage of the term trust is loose. It is messy and even a confused notion. We talk about trusting the bus to be on time, or that this table will not buckle as I lean on it. We say we trust our students to be honest in completing assignments. We talk about trusting our doctor, friends, as well as our cars and the public utilities. It is not clear we mean the same thing in all these situations. Trusting your friend to keep a secret differs from trusting your lawyer to mount a good defense. And trust between a teacher and a student raises special issues of its own that may not exist in other trusting relationships. Any attempt to provide a rigorous definition that captures all features of trust will not suit across contexts where different norms and conditions operate. Rushing to the dictionary is not going to help us here. This doesn't mean, of course, that we can't see anything useful about the concept. So let's see what characteristics of trust, ones that hold across many contexts and situations, can help guide our discussion. So the ways that we use trust in normal conversation are instructive. When I say, I trust the chair not to collapse under me, or I trust the bus to be on time, we're using trust to mean a kind of reliance or confidence. Indeed, trust is often seen as a special form of reliance. But while there is conceptual overlay between the concepts of trust, reliance, and confidence, trust differs from them in important respects. The distinction can, in fact, show what is characteristic about the relations of trust. For example, at least in my teaching role, I'm reliable. I turn up on time, and I'm prepared. Students can be confident I will provide feedback on their work and that I will mess up on Moodle at least once every class period. These are not examples of trust. They are expectations of predictable behavior based on the student's past experience of how I behave. They can predict what I will do with respect to these particular actions, turning up with a lesson plan and having trouble with Moodle. And while we may use trust loosely in this predictive way, it misses an important part of what we mean in saying we trust someone. Trust is an attitude or relation that holds distinctively between people. It is an interpersonal relationship. It concerns the ways we see ourselves in relation to others. As a form of intersubjective responsiveness, it has an ethical aspect to it. Unlike reliance, which can apply to people and things, Trust is most usefully understood as centrally concerned with relations between people. When we trust, we have expectations of the trusted, that she will act in ways that are in our interest or are helpful, but even when our trust is well-founded, there's an element of uncertainty. There is a chance that the one we trust will not act as expected. This could always happen, but in trusting them, we hope they will not harm or disappoint us. Because of the uncertainty involved in trusting, when we trust, we're vulnerable. We are vulnerable because we base our actions on the one trusted, on their anticipated behavior, and we could be disappointed. But what is important here is that when we trust, we don't just acknowledge our vulnerability, we accept it. In trusting, we are saying something like, I am giving something over to you, something I care about, with the expectation that you will take care of it. So far, we seem to be somewhat in agreement with Annette Beyer's influential definition of trust, which is accepted vulnerability to another person's power over something one cares about, in the confidence that such power will not be used to harm what is entrusted. But there's more work to be done. Beyer's definition does not map completely onto our understanding of the teaching-learning relationship. Trust is relational, and how we understand trust is relative to the kind of relationship we're talking about. In our context, this means we need to specify the relationship that holds between student and teacher and see the role that trust plays. And now, of course, that's real murky waters we'll be getting into. So, what kind of relationship are we talking about? The first thing that we can say about the student-teacher relationship is that it's professional. Our students trust us in some part due to our credentials and professional standing. Agnes Scott rightly prides itself on its well-qualified faculty. Look at that, 100% terminal degrees. So, when it comes to trust, the students can rely on our competence in that we have documented expertise. This suggests, however, that the relationship is not one of trust, since trust is only needed when there's uncertainty, where in fact one cannot verify or where one cannot check. Guarantees obviate the need for trust. Perhaps then, there is no need for trust if all the teachers at Agnes Scott are well qualified. But is this right? Obviously not. So we seem to have moved a little too fast. In professional relationships, trust, contrary to what has been said above, is enhanced, not diminished, where there's external confirmation of the domain of competence. In professional relationships, qualifications can act as an invitation to trust rather than eliminate the need for it. The letters after our names may provide grounds for trust. So professional qualifications may form part of a good teaching-learning relationship, but this relationship is more than documented expertise in content. At this point, my students who study the research on teaching and learning with me are nodding knowingly. Being an expert, say, in learning theory is no guarantee that one can teach it. Teaching is more than competence in terms of knowledge of content. Teachers also need what, following Lee Shulman, we call pedagogical content knowledge. This involves many things, such as what is involved in teaching German as opposed to biology, five-year-olds rather than undergraduates, how to organize instructional materials to facilitate learning, and so on. If a teacher has pedagogical content knowledge, would this make them more or less worthy of trust? Unless we have a much more expansive understanding of pedagogical content knowledge, it looks as if we run up against some of the problems that we have with knowledge of content. Here, it's worth reminding ourselves that when we trust someone, it is rarely all-encompassing. We trust someone in a domain or area of competence. I can't remember if I was going to do it first or second. So, here we go. A trusts B to do C. All right, so my students, A, may trust me, B, to teach them about comparative education, but not to bake them a cake. This does not mean that I have to have an exhaustive list of what it means to be competent to teach them comparative education. But if I have demonstrable teaching competence as measured, for example, by qualifications, teaching evaluations, or some other external measures, would this mean that my students can trust me to teach them? I think a doubt should be creeping into our minds. We can recognize competency as a feature of a good teaching-learning relationship and a feature of trust, but to focus on it detracts from what's important in the relationship. My mastery of a set of competencies say something, but they do not talk to what lies at the heart of a good teaching-learning relationship. Teaching and learning, while undoubtedly a professional relationship, is also deeply personal. To be a teacher, as Van Manen, a well-known educationist, says, involves the personal embodiment of a pedagogical thoughtfulness. Teaching stands out as being, in John McMurray's words, one of the foremost of personal relations. Let us see why this might be something we should take seriously by broadening our view for a moment to think about education. There is an inherent uncertainty in teaching and learning. It is impossible to specify the effect of any particular teaching technique on any particular person at any particular time, or even when learning will occur. Students will not respond in the same way to the same instructional technique or the same teaching. The outcomes of teaching are often not immediate, and even with our best laid plans, unpredictable. No matter how well-defined our learning outcomes are, how closely they are correlated with our assignments, how carefully we plan, and how clever our pedagogical techniques are, there is no guarantee, no certainty, that our hopes and intentions will reliably transfer to become part of the experiences of our students. This is because our students bring with them who they are, their memories, experiences, and histories. Their understanding of the world, which includes resistances, desires, along with ways of understanding the world and people like me. Teaching and learning is a complex communicative interaction between people whose interpretations of and relations to what is being taught cannot be neatly contained or slotted into our instructional plans or program outcomes. It is the nature of the educational endeavor that it's indeterminate in this sense. As such, education is risky. It is always and should always be risky in this sense because it's an encounter between human beings. This understanding of education is at odds, however, with the current emphasis on policies and practices designed to reduce, eliminate, or perhaps ignore the riskiness of teaching and learning. And of education itself. These policies and practices look towards learning processes as linear, as able to be made explicit and spoken of in the language of alignment and learning taxonomies. We are encouraged to replace the riskiness of education with an illusory confidence in what makes teaching and learning effective, where there is a correlation between inputs and outputs. On this view, teaching is a specifiable set of competences or techniques that are more or less efficient. There is no need for trust. The interpersonal trust we've been talking about is replaced by something else, perhaps a confidence in measures of accountability. But in doing so, we fundamentally change what we mean by education, and particularly what we mean by education at Agnes Scott. As Biesta warns, if we take the risk out of education, there is a real chance we take out education altogether. So, it is good. While this argument might have a certain poetic force, shouldn't we pause for a moment and consider that the idea of education as something that can be tamed and managed fits snugly with the view of trust that we've been considering. For isn't trust itself in the business of risk management? Trust involves risk, but this need not be seen merely as a way of reducing complexity and contingency in relationships. The role trust plays in education is less risk management and more a recognition of the way in which people, students and teachers, interact. Trust is not a way of managing risk in education, it's a way of acknowledging risk. The commonality in the inherent risk in education and the inherent risk in trust is that both are centrally concerned with people, and people are not completely predictable or manageable and should not be treated as if they were. If they were more like objects to be manipulated, there would be no need to trust, and we would be doing something other than educating when we interact in the classroom. So we're ready now. Okay, so let us return to the story that I told you at the beginning. So this was a story of a student who basically came to me and said, I'm not going to do the work. She came to class and she carried on with her normal behavior, which was always to come to before class and sit outside my room. And she told me that she wouldn't do the work because it contradicted her fundamental beliefs about her life. And so she didn't do the assignments. And then sometime after the rest of the class had finished the unit, she came to me and said she was now ready to do the assignment. She'd worked out a way of getting into the material on her own. Okay. So let's take some central aspects of trust and see how they help us understand this situation. There we go. So when we trust, we're implicitly saying, I am a person and I recognize you as a person. When I trusted the student, let's call her Anna, I was hoping she would find her own way into learning the material. My response to Anna was a personal response. It was to her as a particular person. In trusting me, she also recognized me as a person. We became connected through the trusting relationship. We stood in relation to each other with a willingness to move in response to each other. Trust opened a space so that we could receive what was coming from the other. Trust here could be understood as an openness and responsiveness to the other. In this particular relationship, trust has the effect of turning what might be a more indeterminate type of encounter into a personal relationship. In the trusting relationship, we recognize and accept the independence of the one trusted, and to be dependent on the fact that the other is independent. In this sense, trust is also a personal response. In trusting Anna, I exercise my freedom, a freedom Anna recognized I had, and one she hoped I would exercise in her best interests. In a memorable phrase from somebody who writes on trust, Gambetta, he says, trust is a device for coping with the freedom of others. So when we trust, we have to recognize the other could act differently. In trusting me, Anna was counting on me. She embedded into her plans an expectation where, if it didn't work out, she would be worse off than she would otherwise have been. I could have shut down her learning and penalized her for not doing the work at the time indicated in the syllabus. But by counting on me, she created a dependency. Her success now depended on me responding to her appropriately by recognizing her dependency. Trust thus places us in a certain ethical relationship to each other. Both of us hoped the other would take action or make judgments in the best interests of the one trusting. We counted on each other as we worked towards a common goal, Anna's learning. In the teaching-learning relationship, trust is mutual but asymmetrical. Anna trusts me and I trust her. In an important sense, both of us, in trusting each other, had to reach beyond ourselves and our narrow concern with self. In trusting Anna, I made myself visible as a person and as a teacher, as I gave up the illusion of being in control of the learning. Instead, I trusted Anna's willingness to honestly engage with the material, although I had no idea how she was going to do it or if it would be successful. After all, one trusts when one cannot know and when one does not check up on the one trusted. I had to trust her in order for there to be the possibility of learning. Anna clearly made herself vulnerable in coming to me to say that she wouldn't do the work. To be vulnerable in the classroom seems risky indeed for both student and teacher, but it is important to remember vulnerability has ambivalent potential. It doesn't merely mean being exposed to danger or risk, just as trusting is not merely being exposed to risk. We can, of course, be harmed by our vulnerability, but we can also benefit from it. Vulnerability is also a basic openness to being affected or affecting others. And this can be both positive and negative, of course. How vulnerability is experienced will depend on context. In our case, it's easy to see that vulnerability and the sense of being open to being moved or changed by others is what makes learning possible. Vulnerability can enable us. By opening up and engaging, we are able to transform how we relate to each other and the text. It can be seen as necessary to learning new things about myself, my students, and the world. It is an inevitable part of teaching if teaching is thought of as intentional personal mediating between student and text. Perhaps we should be open to the idea that the vulnerability we experience in teaching and learning shouldn't be avoided, managed, or ignored. Rather, the accepted vulnerability that's part of trust can be seen as a way of being open to new possibilities. And it reminds us that in an educative relationship, none of us is self-sufficient and completely in control. In trusting relationships, we see ourselves as individuals, as separate but interdependent. In educative relationships, we are open, vulnerable to being moved by others and the world, to being changed. In education, a necessarily uncertain enterprise, people accept their vulnerability to each other in order to gain what they could not alone. In doing so, we extend our agency and open ourselves to learning. In the story I've just told, both Anna and I revealed ourselves and accepted our vulnerability as she grappled with how she could protect her beliefs and also learn, and I grappled with how I could present the material in a way that would be meaningful to her. No preconceived lesson plan is going to work here, nor is the withdrawal of either of us from the interaction. Instead, what seems to be needed is a humility that allowed both of us to be open to the risk of education. I hope that we now see that trust is internal to the teaching-learning relationship. Without trust, it wouldn't be intelligible as the kind of relationship it is. All right, so now we get to the objections, because, you don't need them because you're so convinced. But, we have to go back. All right, before concluding, I'd like to address two objections that might be raised to this account of trust. I've chosen these two because I think they can act as umbrellas for some other objections that might be raised. The first concerns my emphasis on the personal nature of teaching and learning, which after all has been the main point. And the second concerns the aims of education. In the first objection, I look to the conception of the person that I've drawn and consider whether it's too abstract to actually do the work I've asked of it. The second objection, in a nutshell, is a response to a question I'm sure many of you are asking. But isn't trust antithetical to many educational aims, and in particular, critical thinking? Mm-hmm. So, objection one. While I've argued for a contextual view of trust and the importance of seeing each other as persons, it may seem I've taken a very thin view of people, persons. I have not addressed persons as people with complex social identities and histories that impact who they trust and how they are trusted. Although trust is a crucial element of human life, this does not mean that it should be recommended as a warranted and sensible attitude in all situations. There is danger in the idea that trust is an unalloyed good. There are often compelling grounds for distrust. Those who have been oppressed are right to be distrustful of those who have colluded in their oppression. Students might be justified, for example, in not trusting an education that ignores, denigrates, or mangles their history, language, or experience. And it's important to recognize that we are not equally trusted, even if the grounds for being trusted are equal. We cannot and should not pretend that social inequities, history, experience, and social identities do not affect trust relationships within the classroom. We don't want to idealize trust or abstract it from larger social realities. Any full treatment of trust would include a robust discussion of when it is appropriate to place trust and when mistrust is justified. I'm going to go on to critical thinking now. I hope I'm on my way to showing the role that trust plays in our work together as students and teachers, but there are likely some among you of a skeptical bent, and we need to address the seemingly obvious tension between trust and critical thinking. Trust seems at odds with a questioning attitude, something we prize here at Agnes Scott, where one of the stated outcomes is to help our students become more adept critical thinkers. Critical thinking is one of the five skills, for example, identified in the leadership program of Summit. Moreover, our students, according to the Princeton Review, describe themselves as ambitious women who think critically about difficult issues. And yet, trust is an attitude whereby, at least on the face of it, one forgoes critical thought in favor of uncritical acceptance. If I trust you, I do not go searching for evidence for what you say. I don't question. Moreover, if I trust you, I'm likely to give weight to your point of view beyond what the evidence might suggest I should, because I trust you. Although there's not time here to address this complex issue in any depth, there is a way of thinking about trust and critical thinking that can enhance our understanding of both. But first, we have to be clear what we mean by critical thinking. And I'm just going to use something from the Agnes Scott website. This is from the section on international students and what they might expect from professors. And so it says, students are encouraged to form and offer their own opinions, to ask questions, and even to challenge presented course material. This is sometimes called critical thinking. This is consistent with the widely held view that critical thinking is concerned with thinking skills, with the development of argument, reasoning from evidence, spotting fallacious reasoning, and the like. Trust, on the other hand, is generally seen as an emotionally weighted attitude, an affective attitude. This does not mean, however, that it is not amenable to reason. Although often unbidden, we just find ourselves trusting, we can also decide to trust. Nothing has been said so far, I hope, to imply that trust is or should be blind. It can be warranted or unwarranted. Although once trust is placed, one no longer seeks reasons to trust, we can have reasons to trust in the first place. Part of education is to help students develop warranted trust both in and outside the classroom. One could and probably should argue that deciding who and when to trust demands good critical thinking skills. But is this enough to reconcile the tension? In order to challenge the professor or the text, the student must trust the professor. In so doing, however, it's not necessary to accept all her arguments or reasoning. Trust, after all, is a personal response that doesn't preclude judgment. We can trust each other while still questioning each other's reasoning. While there will always be a tension, in each particular trusting relationship, it is part of the work of education to ask oneself questions and make judgments. We can always think about trust and consider whether it's warranted. One paragraph to go to the conclusion. So, in my thinking about trust over the past decade, I have focused on what it means to trust my students, to admit their freedom and mine, our vulnerability and responsibility to each other. In doing so, I have learned a great deal from my students. My two goals as a young teacher, this is me in 1982, there we go, to write the perfect lesson plan and to become invisible are still with me. But what they mean has changed. With the help of my students, I have come to realize that when I started teaching, I was missing. And as a consequence, I missed my students as the people they are. Focusing on the bonds of trust that animate and motivate our everyday pedagogical encounters has helped me hold my lesson plans more lightly and hold closer the particular relations between people at the very heart of education. And this is our comparative education class last week. Trust is mostly invisible, and importantly so. But when brought to light, we can see how trust holds education in place. Thank you.
Respecting the student for not participating in the discussion, perhaps fairly obviously not doing the work, and still allow these other students to trust you in your decisions in relation to the student. Does that make any sense?
Yes, it does. And I think, you know, the thing is, it's a very controversial example, right?
Yes.
I mean, it was difficult. Dr. Lewin was teaching at the time, and she remembers how I was agonizing over it. But I think that agonizing over what to do in a particular situation which suddenly arises, that's what it's about. It's about that personal, particular relationship at that time that you can't prepare for. That's why I made those remarks about my lesson plan, because there's no way to plan for that. You just have to be there in the moment and be prepared to trust. I think you have to be prepared to trust. And I do appreciate also the idea that there were 20 other people in the class. And I was very lucky in this case in that she wasn't very demonstrative about not doing her work. She came to class, but she just withdrew. So sometimes students are more quiet. She didn't have a big label which said, I am not doing the work. Because she really did want to learn. She just didn't know how to learn this. So, but thank you for that question. It's very, I think one of the things, I don't want to keep piling the love on Agnes Scott, but I think one of the reasons we can do this so well at Agnes Scott is because we have smaller classes. So you actually do have a personal relationship with everybody in your class. You know everybody. Yes, Dr. Hackett.
Well, I had a question about the example as well. Can you imagine other responses that you could have that also would have manifested trust?
Yeah.
But I'm just wondering, like, sort of, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, I should have asked a yes, no question.
What are some
philosophers? I guess what I'm thinking is, my suspicion is that what prompted you to choose that manifestation of trust had to do with your personal relationship with that student, right?
She's a serious student who had always been, that's why I mentioned the thing about her coming and sitting in the space outside my office. She was a very serious student, and so she was totally distressed that she couldn't do this. Mm-hmm. So even though I was taking a risk in saying, okay, you just go off and see what you can do with this,
So you did say that to her?
Well, no, she said, I can't do it. And I didn't really know what to do right at that very moment. So she said, I can't do this. And I said, well, let's give it some time and see what we can. Can you talk to people, other people, and not me? Because clearly she couldn't talk to me about it, because it was because of her faith and upbringing kind of situation. So I couldn't help with that. And so she just went off and made her own investigations and inquiries and was able to come back. I just feel like if I'd have said to her, no, I'm really sorry, I don't really care about the quality, just write the essay or whatever it was, then she wouldn't have learnt anything, I wouldn't have taught anything, and we'd all have learnt another kind of lesson. Mm-hmm. But you were going to say... Yes, done.
Thank you very much for that talk. What strikes me is I never thought of what happened as trust between a student and teacher. I always thought it was this kind of ethical imperative to use one's powers for good and not evil. and then on the other hand, that the student, in constituting her own education, meets you somewhere in that space that you describe, that space that happens where the trust takes place. It's just I never thought of trust as this critical ingredient in that mix.
I think it's such a rich concept. And, you know, as I said, I mean, it's absolutely true. That first semester, I kept thinking, why do I think this is trust? Why? And I knew nothing. I had read about it or thought about it very much. But it's such a rich concept. It brings up so many things about the ways that we relate to each other. And this, of course, the whole idea of vulnerability, which is, people probably know, is becoming a bigger subject in feminist philosophy right now, as we try to think of not necessarily pushing away our vulnerability, but it seems to be in education, vulnerability is that openness to other, that risk that you take in relation to other, is exactly what education is about. You've got to be open to the other, and that means possibility of wounding.
Yes. Yeah, I really also can't thank you, and that was great, and I like the objections at the end. They make me feel like, is it a philosophy talk? Which in many ways it was, so that was lovely. And I completely agree that, I mean, I think an essential part of that risk is the risk of failure, and you can't learn if you aren't willing to fail, you know, in front of people, and you need to feel not safe, like nothing bad will happen, but in some sense safe with these people. But this kind of brings me back to a similar question, sort of along the lines of what Dr. Lulin was asking earlier, which is, and again, obviously we're focused in on a really crucial aspect of the trust relationship between a professor and a student, or a teacher in another context and a student. But yeah, it seems like an essential, obviously not precluded by that, is the trust of each of the students in your class in each other. Or actually, I'm part of what I was really wondering about is a sense of an individual student with the class as a whole, and that relationship of a professor with the class as a whole. And maybe you think that that's a wrong way to think about individual students as constituting a class that has its own personality in a way. But I think we've all had, whether as students or professors, been in classes where the students as individuals come across one way, the class dynamic as a whole is a whole other thing, for good or ill, right? And that there's a kind of, there are dynamics between the professor and a class which might be different from the professor's relationships with individual students. And so I just wondered if you had any, if you'd gotten that far into thinking about whether there was not just different dynamics, but trust relationships that you thought about in terms of, I mean, obviously, as a professor, one wants to facilitate trust among the individual students in the class in various ways. It also seemed like there might be some concerns about how to facilitate trust between the professor and the class as a whole, as opposed to just individual relationships.
It's such an interesting topic, I think, thinking about how we, and I'm not sure this is what you're asking, but how do we develop relationships of trust? Because, as you know from the literature is all about, you only see it in the breach. It's a negative, and rebuilding it, you know, it's very hard and difficult. But we start, I mean, our students come to us trusting. we're already in a good place. So they come to us expecting to be educated, they're looking forward to it, they think that we're competent and all of those other good things. So we're already starting from a good place, I think. Then I have experimented with things called things like therapeutic trust. You know, treating people as if they were trustworthy. So in other words, before I even know them, go, well, I just trust you all. And trying to see if that's actually trust and what effect that might have on a class. But I think generally acknowledging the role of trust and actually sometimes talking about it with the students and the role of it in education can be beneficial. But clearly there's a difference between the individuals as individuals and the class as a class, which of course is always different. But it definitely deserves more thought. Thank you for that very thoughtful comment. Yeah.
I love your example for various reasons, but some of what I like about it is how it shows you choosing to be vulnerable with her, which might explain why she trusted you. Because not using your subject position as the teacher who gives you the grade and say, listen, it's in the syllabus, and I have a lesson plan for it. it's 15% of the final grade. You didn't go there, so you became vulnerable with her, basically acknowledging and coping with her independence, as you said. So that's a terrific example. But I have a question. If we think about trust as an interpersonal relationship, since you taught in different contexts, co-ed, and then here at Agnes Scott, does the nature of the trust change?
I think that, you see, for me, that is the most interesting question. Because it happened my first year at Agnes Scott that I kept thinking, started to think about these things. And I kept thinking, what is different about what's happening here to where I was before? I wondered whether it was my subject, because before I really was in teacher education, which, as we know, well, most of us know, very low status. So there's a lot of like, why should we trust you? What do you know? You're not really a teacher, you're a teacher educator instead of being somebody in the classroom. And, there's all sorts of trust issues going on, sometimes from your subject position. I wondered about gender. I wondered a lot about those things because it seemed that that first semester here, there was a lot of trust in me as a professor, but they demanded trust from me too. They said I should trust them in so many different ways. And they made it more like a partnership right from the beginning. And I did find it different from where I'd been before. Now I'm sort of in it. So that's why I go back to my journals from that first year, because I kept thinking, what on earth is happening here? Why is this, why does it seem that I can, I'm not saying my teaching improved, but I did feel I was a better teacher in a trusting environment. I mean, one of the ways I wanted to write this paper was totally from my perspective as somebody who was trusted and what that did for me and how it enabled me to teach better because people trusted me. But I do think there's something that we do here. That's why I spoke about the good air that we breathe. I know that we have problems with trust. I'm not being Pollyanna-ish about it. But I think in general, we're in a very good place when it comes to teacher-student engaging with the text for the purpose of education and recognizing some of the vulnerabilities and risks that we take around that, and that it's only possible when we trust each other.
To talk to you a bit about the question of vulnerability and your vulnerability like Yael, but to go back to an earlier example that you shared at the beginning of the lecture, I think it was a journal entry where you said you had expressed your ambivalence about experiential learning with students and made yourself vulnerable and how that made you feel. That really resonated with me and something that I've struggled with as a teacher, feeling that pull to disclose my views, but then worry about that changing the power dynamic within the classroom. And I vividly remember this particular moment in my teaching career where he said, on the very first day of class, students said, "So, do you believe in God?" And I was, kind of bowled over by this. Oh my gosh, you're crossing all these boundaries. And it was this sort of demand for me to make myself vulnerable to students. So, I guess my question to you is, in that example, of, which seems different from, I mean, related, it's all related, but it brings up a different set of issues around making yourself vulnerable. In that instance, what I heard from the example was by sharing your own views in a way that could invite students to see you as a shared, as also a person on the journey of learning, and so therefore be a very positive thing, but could also kind of close things off by saying, oh, but that's what she thinks.
It's extremely tricky, I think. Clearly it's got to be about the text, it's got to be context related, and, you know, I remember when I first started teaching photography before this, you know, the students would ask me what my first name was I married, did I have children, you know, all of this stuff. Now, I always pushed those aside because I thought, that's none of your business, and we're talking about Shakespeare right now, just shut up, it's Shakespeare. I realized that thing about missing myself, I never thought I was important in a relationship. But I think so if we are important in the teaching relationship, then something of ourselves has to be revealed. And that's always going to be, and you know, it's not like friends, it's a professional relationship. So there's got to be a revealing that enables learning. So it's always, I hate to always say it depends on context, but there's, so like for example, getting passionate about the text, explaining that you really do feel in a certain way about this, and you are ambivalent about it, you, not people in the secondary literature of ambivalent, you are, and you feel strongly about this. I think that can actually open yourself up. If it is a genuine feeling and it's appropriate, then you do make yourself vulnerable, and I think that can help. I think that can be part of the learning relationship. Does that answer? Yes.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the vulnerability too, because it seems like what's at stake here is some conception of ourselves that we are risking. And so that led me to think about different contexts in which we might need to express greater or lesser vulnerability, there, to the extent that there are greater or lesser personal aspects at stake. So for example, I was trying to think about how important trust might be when I'm teaching a relatively impersonal subject like logic, as opposed to when I'm teaching things that might be challenging my students' worldviews. So do you think that trust might be less essential when we're dealing with impersonal situations, and why not?
Because you just took me straight back to my logic class. He was so impersonal. We might as well not have been in the room. And I remember at one point, while we were doing some horrible Polish logic thing, that we actually had the temerity to raise our hands and say, you're going a bit fast. And I remember him looking, suddenly realizing there were people in the room. I said, what if it's too fast? You should just leave. I don't know. It's like, we go at this pace, because this is the pace you go at, and if you can't follow, you shouldn't be here. You know, I mean, that's as simple as that. He could have listened to us. He could have done lots of things to have a relationship with us. That he could have reached out. He could have like talked. I mean, he doesn't have to talk about his own struggles with logic, because I'm sure he'd forgotten them by that stage. But he could have made a personal connection. I'm not saying he would have made. I can't imagine this man ever making himself personally memorable in that way. But you can imagine that being part of the relationship. I mean, everybody's going to do it in their own way, right? But I do think it's part. I think being open, if education is being open to being changed, that means there's a possibility of things going awry. And since we can't manage everything, then we've got to allow for all those possibilities. And logic should be like that too.
This is just an anecdote. I took a course one time in graduate school called Informal Set Theory. This is like symbolic logic off the chart. Don't ask me why. I did that, but the teacher was the best teacher I've ever had. And because, and this is the only member I have of him, he searched the faces of each one of the people in the class. And he wouldn't pass for the next step or theorem or whatever it was until he thought that he saw understanding or maybe the dawning of the light of understanding. I just followed my life. I don't know what that has to do with trust, but this is
true. And, you know, and I just...
Logic, I mean, the worst kind of logic, what are you going to do?
Yes. Yes. I think that... I mean, I might not be. I mean, we could come up with some really good examples where trust isn't needed. I mean, online teaching, maybe. Maybe there doesn't need to be any trust. I mean, and we learn from other things. But I was just thinking about this particular relationship and the role that trust might play in it. And then the more I thought about what education was, it just seemed to me more and more central. I know I overplayed the case a bit, you know, saying that the whole thing would fall apart if we didn't have trust. But I think if we can recognize the value of trust in most educative relationships, then I think we're, I think particularly for me, is the vulnerability of the teacher is the very important part of this. Yes.
So one of the things that has struck me on faculty here, as opposed to elsewhere where I've been a student, is that faculty prefer to be called Dr. So-and-so, and nowhere else where I've been has had that tradition. And my first years couldn't handle it. I told them to call me Iris, and that was like impossible for them. But my upperclassmen, they can, or upperclassmen, they can handle it. And they look sheepishly delighted every time they say my first name. And I never thought of that as a thing of trust, but just I just my name. It seems like who they should call me, and maybe that's something related to what you're talking about.
Yeah,
but it just seems like the right thing to do.
Yeah. Bryn calls me Lesley. I always say to my classes at the beginning, it's Lesley or Dr. Coia, and that's exhausted it. But I felt the same way when I came, because I'd always been called Lesley. And students, they can choose. And they can call me what they want.
Well, but related to that, I mean, the one word that hasn't come up is in your presentation is power.
It did come up. In the objection. I had it in there.
Okay, sorry. But I think it could tie into this idea of trust. You talked about vulnerability. I mean, to be vulnerable is to sort of open yourself up to being hurt, which is to give power to the other party.
Or to have something good come in.
It could be, yes, but it's a risk, right? Yes, so we talk about risk and vulnerability. You're talking about power. When you give your students the right to use your first name, you are equalizing the power imbalance, right?
Not necessarily.
In some ways, right? I mean, the doctor is a formal title of address that elevates the addressee, right? So, Tina, I guess, talks a lot about democratic pedagogies and everything. And I wonder whether you see some of those techniques of reducing the power imbalance as being in line with the establishment of trust. Is that one of the ways that you can build trust?
I don't know. I think authority is important. I think there are many different issues there. I think inequities in general are much more important. And authority and recognizing legitimate authority and legitimizing your authority in relation to your students. And the name thing may come in there somehow, but I think those questions are, when we're talking about trust, are really important. It's not what I'm doing. But I do think that we have to recognize that trust is not just this nice, lovely thing that we can just pass between or have between us and bring us closer together and all those stuff. It's all muddy with what's happening, all the inequities outside. You know, a lot of the stuff on trust was started by feminists who were talking about how women have been socialized to trust too much, and they're not trusted because they're women, and so it's always had a very, very clear social justice aspect to it, most of the discussions of trust. So clearly all of that needs to be addressed, and that's why I put in that little objection there, because I know that, and I know that the trust relationships are not going to be equal. Some students come in totally trusting, and other students may come in totally suspicious about what's going on here, and we have to recognize that. It's time for asparagus.
Hard. I didn't realize I was supposed to make closing remarks. Lesley, Dr. Coia, thank you so much. You know, you said at the start that you hoped that we would emerge as intrigued and excited by the concept of trust as you are, and I think it's clear from all of the questions that you have made us all think deeply about this, and as teachers and as learners. And so thank you so very much.
Thank you for that.